Is a goal of yours playing in the NBA again someday?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Why is that? Why is that important for you to make a comeback?
Because I love the game. And there's a part of me that is, you know, again, in order to have a conversation forthright, you have to be willing to become vulnerable in your own stature and your own status. And there's a part of me that just likes to domineer other athletes. That's not right. That's not ideal. But it's something that was ingrained in me from being a lifelong athlete. So there's a part of me that just wants to go toe-to-toe with LeBron and have at it, have a good tilt.
Would you really play for free? Or were you just
absolutely.
You would play in the NBA for free?
For free, complete. They wouldn't let me. But I'll take it a step further. I'll donate whatever salary they give me to mental health, and all of the owners and all of the peripheral sponsors can match that. If that's the minimum, $865,000 or whatever the minimum is nowadays, I'll donate it because I can't technically play for free. The union wouldn't let me. But I'll donate my salary to mental health, and I'd ask for a call for all of the people that are entwined with the NBA on the economic side to match that donation.
You had so much success with Fred Hoiberg.
Mm-hmm.
He's in Chicago now.
Mm-hmm.
If he picks up the phone, doesn't that seem like that would logically make a whole lot of sense to reunite you guys?
I think that's a great question. I mean, I think that's a great question. And ultimately, not to beat a dead horse, but I think it speaks to how the mental health topic has not been progressed. Because the Chicago Bulls would much rather be one of the worst teams in the NBA than rejoin me and my coach that we had one of the most prolific college seasons in recent memory. I still get calls and messages today about people who explicitly only remember me from the NCAA tournament, not being drafted or anything that happened after or before, but explicitly that. And it was because the style that we played had an energy and a vibe and a funness to it. And the fact that he was willing to let a 265-pound guy play the point guard had a magnetism to it. And the fact that the Bulls would much rather be one of the last place teams in the Eastern Conference rather than reunite us speaks to the stigma.
Now, do you think playing in the NBA again is realistic?
No.
No.
No, I don't believe that. Here's the issue, is that when you avoid a topic, the steps that you need to take in order to make up the ground become more extreme. We see that in all walks of life, specifically health, in an ironic way. You know, I use this example all the time. Let's say you have a benign tumor,
yep.
But the doctor says, hey, listen, you may be predisposed to malignant tumors or malignant cancer. You smoke 7 cigarettes a day. When you get that diagnosis, you get that prognosis or that recommendation, the move isn't to go, I'm gonna cut back by 7 cigarettes a day. It's I need to cut back by 7 packs.
Yeah.
Now, the trouble is I can't cut back by 7 packs now because I've built a habit. That wouldn't be safe either, but I do have to start to build my way towards being totally done smoking. And those are the types of sentiments and perspectives that I bring to this conversation within the confines of sports, is that we've let this topic go on unacknowledged for so long that our action will seem extreme to rectify that.
So is what you're saying that?
What I'm saying is that the relationship with Budweiser has to change. Letting the fans come to the games and drink as much as they want to and yell at the players in front of their kids and other people's kids is morally and ethically irresponsible.
Totally agree with that.
And on another note, the psychological effect that it has on the players and how it predisposes them to do things like smoke marijuana is a conversation that they don't even want to have yet.
So is it then the return of the NBA is on your side? You don't think you want it to happen, or is it them?
No, I want it to happen. I just don't think that they, I think that them knowing that I have a willingness to speak that way about the issues is a total non-starter for them. It's not for me. I'm willing to come to the table and just talk about this and actually figure out why it is that we couldn't have an alcohol cutoff at the game.
Right.
Maybe there's some really good reason. I don't know one. I'm only 27, though. You're talking about people who are in their mid-40s and 50s and owners that are in their 60s and 70s who have, you know, a decent history within the business constraints. So maybe there's a reason, but I see an alcohol cutoff at pro sporting events as entirely reasonable.